Let's talk a little bit about interpreting IR spectra. So this video is going to focus on spectral analysis and interpreting the IR spectrum rather than a discussion of the theory of IR spectroscopy. So we're going to more take a spectroscopy analysis approach of identifying an unknown compound rather than what goes into IR spectroscopy. So let's review our integrated spectroscopy approach. So the purpose of this approach is to identify an unknown compound. And we've got a few steps that we're going to take throughout the course in this order to determine the identity of a unknown compound. So the first thing we want to do is to interpret the IR and get the functional groups, get the low-hanging fruit, the easy information that we can get very fast. And so that's what we're going to talk about here. You get a molecular formula and a molecular weight later from the mass spectrometry. And then we nail down the fine structure of the molecule with HNMR and CNMR. And then depth and 2D techniques if we need it. But we're going to focus right now on interpreting IR spectra and getting the functional groups from an unknown compound. Okay, so the way that I like to do this is we're going to look at all IR functional groups in a single visual figure. So I'm going to draw a spectrum, and the only parts of this spectrum I'm concerned about are the areas between 1500 wave numbers and 3000 wave numbers. So the only numbers we need to learn are those two. And every time we interpret a spectrum, we draw a line at 1500 and 3000, we ignore the fingerprint region, and we analyze only the rest of the spectrum, which is the functional group region. And so if we start at 1500 and move left, the first thing we encounter is a very sharp, needle-like signal that is a CC bond, a CC double bond, okay? And then in this similar region, at around 1700 wave numbers or thereabouts, we see a little bit thicker, finger-like CO double bond. So if we put all of these together and visually determine what they look like, then we have a greater chance of solving the spectrum. In the same region, a little bit further, we might have the aromatic overtones. So these are the aromatic teeth, but they're overtones that look like fangs. They can be short, large, you know, sometimes they're hard to tell, and so we have to be careful. And then right in the middle of this region, between 1500 and 3000, we see a very sharp needle-like signal that could correspond to CC triple bonds and CN triple bonds, and that appears right in the middle. Okay, the next thing we might see is to the right of 3000, we might see signals, looks kind of like a dog's ear, like a hound dog, but these are sp3ch stretches. Okay, so the CH bond stretching in and out, all of these are stretches that we've looked at so far, other than the overtones, okay? So they're all stretching in and out and giving us this signal. Sometimes these are smaller or larger than other signals, okay? Then immediately to the left of 3000, sometimes even blurring onto the 3000 line, we might see sp2ch stretches. And then a little further over, we might even see spch stretches. So whenever you see an sp2ch, look to verify that there's a CC double bond. Likewise, when there's an SPCH, look and see if you've got a triple bond, because that can tell us whether or not we're interpreting the spectrum correctly. And then further past 3000, we run into the large singlet that is OH. Okay, so the OH stretch shows up in this region as a long singlet because it's more acidic. Some other things we can garner from the spectrum. I'm going to change color to kind of highlight the difference. In this region where the CC double bond exists, we can have a shorter version of that, which is the NH bend. Okay, so this is a scissoring bending action away from or toward the lone pair. Okay, so this is just a bend back and forth. NH bend, and it looks like a shorter, wider version of the CO double bond. And so this occurs for primary amines and amides. Okay, this is very prevalent for primary amines and amides for structures like that. So they might show up there. And then we might also see an aldehyde CH stretch here. Okay, so it's the CH that's doing this. And these are very hard to interpret. So I say beware and check the HNMR to verify that this particular compound is there. You have to have a CO double bond to have an aldehyde, but you don't always have an aldehyde when it looks like you might have an aldehyde from that region. Okay, so further to the right of sp3ch, and then in the same region as the OH we might have an NH stretch. Okay, so NH may show a singlet, a doublet, or a triplet sometimes, so it looks like a very large and lumpy version of the OH, and that just depends on if you have a primary or secondary amine that would show up in that region in the same as the OH. Okay, so I would memorize how all of these look and then apply them to spectra that you analyze. So this is everything in one place, with a quick note that the OH stretch can extend out to the rest of the spectrum if you have a carboxylic acid present. So that is one thing else that we do want to add, is we would see that OH stretch and become very wide and be split by 3,000 if it were a carboxylic acid OH. Okay, so if we learn how the spectra look with respect to the two numbers that we've given, 1500 and 3000, it's very easy to analyze spectra. So let's do a few examples that follow this method. So we're going to draw our line at 1500 wave numbers for this spectrum, and then 3000. So the only thing we see here, sp3ch, dog ear to the right of 3000, and then we see the OH stretch. Okay, we don't see anything else. You know, a little line here can indicate, you know, noise on the baseline versus overtones, but we have nothing else that we can identify. So this is an alcohol. We can't tell what else is on the compound until we get to NMR, but we know it's all alkyl groups and OH. It could be a halide, or at least halides and ethers are IR silent, so we wouldn't be able to see them if they were there, but we at least know that we have an alcohol for this particular spectrum. To the next, 1500, 3000, we have a sharp needle-like CC stretch here. We have a very sharp needle-like sp2ch. We have sp3CHs here, so we've got at least an alkene functional group in this molecule. Okay, very easy to see, and again, our noise level here, this is not part of the main signal. Hard to tell on some of these, but we want to look at the most intense signals as being the most reliable. Okay, again, 1500, 3000. Okay, if I could draw a straight line, we'd be in good shape. Okay, but we've got sp3ch, and we're like, these might be sp2chs because they're the left of 3000, but I can't draw a straight line, so are we right? Well, sure, we're right. We have here a CC double bond stretch, and we also have aromatic overtones. Okay, so we've got the aromatic teeth here that also indicate that we've got some alkyl group attached to an aromatic ring. So the base of that compound is going to look like this, although there could be other substituents as well. But there's some kind of substituent on an arene ring, maybe more than one substituent. Okay, and then finally here in the last spectrum we'll look at, in these examples, draw your line at 1500, draw the line at 3000, and say, okay, here's an sp3ch signal here. Could it be an aldehyde? Well, there's no double bond, no CO double bond signal, so no, it can't be an aldehyde, but what we do have is a CC triple bond, and then clear evidence for an SP hybridized CH. So we've got some alkyne that looks like this is our structure for our unknown compound. Okay, so hope this helps.